we talked about some of the social impact of all this technology. Right now, I'm going to talk about the technology itself. What is possible today? And I'll focus on what we do, which is we try and make cities safer, smarter, and more efficient, and we have a value proposition that we do it at zero incremental costs, and you'll see how that happens. So the focus is not on the sort of stuff that we will be able to do in 2 years and 5 years and so on. I'm going to talk about what is possible right now. And all this involves a combination of artificial intelligence, multi-sensory analysis, data sciences, etc. So let's look at what's happening in the world. You know about all these places, you know, Istanbul, Bangkok, Paris, etc. All of them have the world's best cameras. They have the world's best technology. They have the world's best recording systems. How is it that they can't stop all these events from happening? What constrains them? Right? Let's just look at this one incident in Belgium, Brussels. Right? You remember the incident? Those two guys over here. They blew themselves up. That guy over there, he left a bag. 30 people died. They caught him after 3 days. Question is, why did it take 3 days? They had him on their most wanted list because he was involved in Paris just a month before. They should have seen him as he walked into the airport, but they didn't. And the reason is that, in fact, people put in lots of cameras around the city, around airports and railways and so on. But studies show that if somebody's sitting and watching just two monitors, after 10 minutes, they miss half the action. After 20 minutes, they see nothing. So there's no point in having thousands of cameras. It's a total waste of money. I'll prove it to you because I will give you a test. You are now the guard, all right? In this environment, you're the guard. See these faces, if one of them comes in, you tell me, okay? Ready? 3, 2, 1, go. There. Of course you won't see anyone, but that's the job we give our guards, right? That's four cameras. That's what they will see. And what do you think is going to happen in Sydney trains where they have 20,000 cameras and three people watching them? Right? Let me fast forward you. And you'll see over there in that top left-hand corner, we found someone. Right? We found someone, we pull out his information, we say, okay, he's a person that we know of, we want to catch him. On camera one, it was that particular guy. Yeah. But on camera four, while you were watching camera one, on camera four, somebody left a bag and walked away. So you didn't notice that, because you were watching camera one. Right? And that's where video analysis comes in. It tells you what is happening where. On camera 20, somebody's had a car accident. On camera 200, somebody's fallen down. On camera 500, John's just walked into the front door, that sort of stuff. Now let me give you a different example. In Singapore, they had a riot. A bus ran over a local laborer. Hilden, his friends got upset. They set fire to the bus. It became a riot. See the timing over there. 9:23, the accident happens. 9:25, police cars are mobilized on their way. 8 minutes, the ambulance arrived. 1 hour, they've gone home. Next day, 24 people are charged. What was the difference in Singapore relative to Brussels? How can Singapore do it in 2 minutes? How can they react in 2 minutes compared to Brussels, where it takes them 3 days? And of course, the difference was in Singapore, we had implemented the Singapore Smart City project, where we'd implemented what we call an automated response system. And the way that works is that from the camera itself, the camera understands what's happening. And when I say understand, it's not just a camera. Humans use their eyes, they use their ears, they use their nose. So So we aren't talking only of video analysis, we're talking about sound analysis, smell analysis, all working together. Right, and just to give you an example, if somebody falls down, you might say, oh, he's falling down, don't help him. On the other hand, if you hear a gunshot at the same time, you might say, don't go there, somebody's got a gun. So you can change your reaction based on the information you get. So anyway, from the camera itself, the camera sends information not to a control room, but it looks for the nearest responder, which could be the nearest police car, the nearest ambulance, the nearest whatever, and tells them where to go and what to do. I'll give you an example of this with a little video.
RMSU's speciality is the ability to provide multiple video analytics in very complex scenes. As you can see, a person has dropped a bag. He has abandoned it and he is walking away. The bag is being obscured by people walking in front of it and it is hardly visible. The system has found the bag. This is our speciality. We can cope with situations where the object is significantly obscured. We now do the jump to event, which takes you back to the moment the bag was first brought into the scene. It doesn't matter how long back that was. The system can see who left the bag, can pull out his face, and enroll him in a watch list. This face can then be transmitted to all the other cameras within the network. At this stage, we don't know who that person was, but we do have an image of him, and we can search for him across the various cameras in the network. Now, in this view, we have seen the person again, and we can pull out whatever additional information we have about the person. The next step is to track him. We can track him on different cameras, where we have seen him, and we know that he is finally now at that last camera shown in red. From that point, we can find the nearest policeman, and the system sends the information to him on his smartphone. He will ask who this person is, and we can send him as much information as we have on him. He will ask what he has done, and we can send him the jump to event video. The entire process is patented. The ability to find a bag in a crowded scene, even where the bag is obscured, the ability to do the jump to event, and to see who left the bag there, the ability to do face recognition in a crowded scene in a totally uncontrolled environment, the ability to find the nearest policeman, and in fact this entire process of automated response is patented by RMSU.
So what was the benefit in Singapore? Their benefit was response time. In normal traffic accident situations, it used to take them something like 25 minutes to respond to an accident. They were able to reduce that response time to under 5 minutes. And the benefit of that, of course, is that you get less congestion during traffic accidents and things like that. But also, if you are the victim, if you have your leg under the truck, you know, 20 minutes is a long time to wait for the ambulance. So the technology has evolved significantly in the last decade from what they called VMS systems, which were essentially video recording and display systems, to recent systems, which are where they bring in more than video, other door alarms, bar alarms, but it's still recording and display, right through to what we call automated response, where the camera will find the responder, tell them where to go and what to do. Now, to make something like this work, you need some very strong core analytics. And of course, when we went to the market, you know, everybody said, yeah, we can do all that. So we came up with something called an IQ rating system, which measured the intelligence of our own technology. Just like human IQ, the way human IQ works is that an IQ of 100 is the average of the whole population. That means 50% of the population has an IQ of more than 100, like all of you in this room, and there's another 50% downstairs somewhere. All right. So we rated our products based on IQ level. There are some limited IQ products, average IQ, medium IQ, and so on. I'll show you what you can do at each level. Now, this was our own rating system for our own products, but about 6 weeks ago, the ISO Standards Committee for Video Analysis met and they asked us to talk about this, and they decided to use this as the basis for their rating system. So let's start at the bottom of the scale. At the simplest level, you do things in empty scenes. So here's a railway track, somebody's crawling in, you can see him over there, and we call them and we raise an alarm. At the next level, you can do things like counting. You count people going in, people going out. You can do this very accurately, probably up to 99% accuracy. When you start going higher, you now start doing things like this in a crowd. So this is in the Hajj in Mecca, where you say, okay, there's an area of interest over there. How many people are in there? If the number of people in there get to more than X, you need to shut the door, stop the more people coming in, and so on. You can do other behaviors, things like fighting, car accidents, all sorts of things. This is an example of a slip and fall. Somebody's going to fall down over here. You'll notice the camera quality is very poor. You don't need high resolution, expensive cameras. This, you know, I think it's a cheap $20 camera from China. Found somebody, it raises an alarm, you can go and help him, hopefully he won't sue you. Now we're getting to the more, the higher IQ's technology. You'll notice this is much more crowded. Therefore, it's much more complex to handle because you can't use the traditional motion detection capability. Everybody moves. You see this guy in the white? He's done something, he's left. Back, you can walk in front of it, obscure it. The system has found it. Now, if you said, can you find a bag? We would find it with an IQ of 60. And of course, 100 other companies can do that too. So what's unique about IQ 140 at the top? It is, you can find the bag in a crowd, despite obscuration. That's what makes it different. And now let me take you to one level above that. You'll notice over here, right at the top, we found something. You can go back and do the jump to event. It'll take you back to the moment it happened, even if it was 2 weeks ago. You see that guy, he is, Walked in, he's going to put his bag down and he is going to walk away. But you can't see the bag. It's a black bag on a black background. So if you were watching this, you would not see it. But of course, the system has found it. And the reason I say there's only one of us who does it is because we have the international patents for doing that. Now, the key problem in all these technologies is the false alarm rate. So we have something, an artificial intelligence module called NAMS, a nuisance alarm minimization system, to help you ignore the false alarms. So let me shut down the noise. So in this scene, you'll see here there's a man, there's a dog, the trees are moving. We have to be able to ignore those trees moving. We have to be able to ignore the dog because we only want to catch the man. The man will come back in a second and he will pretend to be a dog. He'll go down on all fours. There, but we know it's still a man. Right? So that's the impact of NAMS, and that's extremely important because if you get 200 false alarms every night, you know, people will shut the system down. Cannot use it. The system has to be self-learning, it has to have self-diagnosis, it has to know not just if the camera is disconnected, but also if it can't see properly because of rain, because it's out of focus, because it's moved, and so on. And we have something called IQ Infinity, where we run all these applications, about 80 of them, on the same camera at the same time. And using the same building blocks, you can do other things like smoke and fire detection, queue management, fever checks, and so on. Up to now, we've only talked about behavior analysis. The next step is recognition, recognizing who was involved in that behavior. And for recognizing, you're usually recognizing vehicles. So you're talking about license plate recognition and face recognition. License plate recognition is a fairly traditional technology and a lot of people have it. You'll see over there, this is in Mumbai. It recognizes at very high accuracy with motorcycles, cars, buses, whatever. The more interesting technology is face recognition, again, in a crowd. The traditional face recognition, the biometric type face recognition that you're talking about, is done this way. You'll have seen it in the airport where they say, take off your spectacles, don't smile, look straight, and they take a picture and let you through the airport. We're talking about doing face recognition like that. Let me give you some examples. That's in a football stadium in Colombia. You'll notice we're doing 75 faces at a time on a 1 megapixel camera. Your phone probably has 5, right? So this is a very low resolution camera, but it'll recognize people. You can do face recognition on other examples. This was on a YouTube video. Right. So as long as there's video coming in, you can use the technology for whatever it is that you need. There are different applications for it. For example, this is an access control system. Now it was in a shipbuilding yard for Keppel shipyards, one of the world's largest shipbuilders. There are 20,000 people coming in, and each guy swipes his card and he comes in. Challenge you have is that I might not be the owner of my car. I might be using your car, right? And they had a serious problem with that because, you know, I might be a welder. I'm feeling sick, so I send my brother-in-law in just to take the wages, and he's not a welder. So they have a camera in front, and they check that when I swipe my car, that I am the owner of my car. So the technology can be used on drones, on wherever there's a camera. So this is an example from a moving camera. It's looking for someone in the crowd and it's found them. You can use the technology for other things like dwell time, to know how long did people spend in the chocolate section of the shop, how long did they spend in the vegetable section. How long will it take them to go through the security section of the airport, and so on. Now, there is the issue of privacy that we talked about earlier. That's an interesting challenge because, as John said, wherever you go, there are cameras. Today, you are watched wherever you go. In fact, this technology makes it more private for you because we can actually redact all the faces. So we can fix it so that anybody watching can't see anything. Only the system knows, and the system can make decisions. For instance, if it says, okay, there's some of the alarm that just turned up at Sydney Airport, the system will raise an alarm. And then the authorities have a special tool for unreacting that part of the news. Right? So only people who are authorized to do so can then look at whatever it is they are authorized to look at.
5 minutes.
So a system like this.
5 minutes resting.
A system like this can greatly improve the privacy. Let me take you a little forward. Okay, so the next thing is to try and use this video in practice, and everyone's talking about cloud computing and things like that. The real challenge is if you have 2-3 megapixel video cameras, you're not going to send that video to the cloud because even the NBN is not going to be able to cope with thousands of cameras sending high resolution video. So we have a smart compression technology which will compress everything in the video except what is important based on some rules. Like it'll save the face in high resolution, but the rest of me can be low resolution because we don't need my shoes in high resolution. And doing it that way can save something like 90% of the storage and bandwidth, and that allows you to actually implement such a system in the cloud. So this, in fact, becomes a significant disruptive factor, because it means you can implement a smart system at a lower cost than a dumb system. And we did that recently. We went to RIM prisons, and they said, oh, we love your technology, but we have no money. And we said, we're going to spend $2 million on the site. We said, yeah, but you're spending it on the cameras, the computers, this, that. We said, let us redesign. The whole project came in at $1.8 million instead of $2 million, because we saved them $800,000 on their storage. Okay. So this is what the architecture would look like. So the cameras feed into a little device like that, or it can go directly to a server if you have the bandwidth. It can raise alarms on a smartphone, it can send things to a central location where you can do your big data analysis. What is big data? It's bringing information in from many sources and analyzing it. But it's always takes. You know, you can go to Twitter and Facebook and just send it. It's always takes. So what do you do with video, sound, even smell? In real time, we convert this into what you call meaningful metadata, we convert it into text. So we say there's a blue car going down the one-way street. Once we've said it in words, then we can analyze it. So the systems can be used to predict events before they happen. They can be used to respond quickly when they do happen, and to investigate it afterwards, after the event. We actually build information packs for 30 different industries, because industries, you know, people in the industry don't understand what is IP10 and IP100. So for a stadium, we might have a whole number of applications. They may not care so much about terrorism. Their key problem might be finding lost children. So the technology is adapted for their particular requirements. Retail have their own issues and so on. You see, there are hundreds of applications for railways. They're just doing the Northwest Rail Link, and they're implementing a lot of this. Roads and traffic. All these are just different applications based on that same technology that we've been looking at. Right? And you can have smart banking for anti-fraud at ATMs, smart hospitals, etc. And when you put all these things together, smart banks, smart schools, smart hospitals, that is what we call a smart city. So we've implemented such systems in 47 countries, across 30 different industries. Just to give you a little background on us, we are an Australian company based in Chatswood. And the value proposition we take to customers is we can do it with less cameras, less storage, less bandwidth, faster response times, and more accurate information. What I'll do is just end up with a video which shows you some of our customers and people who use this technology, and I'm open to questions.
Rustam, may I speak on behalf of the audience to say I think we could actually probably have a whole day's workshop just with what you've shown us. You've blown my mind this morning, and I'm sure we could literally have 5 hours of questions, and I look forward to a time when we can co-design and talk about things of the future. I'm going to go straight to questions. Go for it, Liria.